We're in this series called The Last Words of Jesus, and Jesus' words alone are powerful. His words hold life in them. They hold the answers in them, but his last words are so meaningful because they can give us an insight to how to endure the worst day of our life, maybe our painful days, our difficult times, because how Jesus endured that and how he responded to that gives us a framework. It gives us a strategy how we can maybe go through some of those days, some of those painful experiences, and be victorious and overcome, just as Jesus did. How many of you have ever had a bad day before? Anyone ever had a bad day? Come on now. Yeah. Yeah. How many of you are sitting next to your bad day? No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. He came in with me, Pastor. Yeah. It feels like this day, you guys, that it's called Good Friday. I talked about this last week. It's called Good Friday, but there was really nothing good about this day. I mean, the benefit of it, yeah, but for Jesus, this was the worst day of his life. This was the most painful day, the day he kind of dreaded. He was not looking forward to this day. It was a day where Jesus faced betrayal and torment, a day of lying tongues, a day of beatings, a day of false accusations and humiliation, a day of loneliness and rejection. It was a God-forsaken day in which God himself died. That's the day. It was a day like no other. Our worst days don't compare anything to the day Jesus had, but there are parts of this story in that actually are like our bad days. And so we're going to draw some insights from what Jesus experienced so that we can endure, so that we can become victorious just as he was victorious. It's an example that he set for us. The word of God tells us how to live through our most painful days and let Jesus be our example. Here's our theme verse, Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. It says, keep your eyes on Jesus. I love that, you guys. Keep your eyes. And this is what we're doing for, it's a 7-week series, so 6 more weeks, all the way leading up to Easter. We are keeping our eyes on the cross, keeping our eyes on Jesus. Now look, if you're in the middle of a painful season, bad days, difficult days, if that's you and you're in the middle of it, this could probably be every message I could ever preach up here and just say, go home. Just keep your eyes on Jesus. And this is exactly what we're going to do for the next 6 weeks. We're just going to keep our eyes, see how Jesus did it. How did he endure? Man, that's going to give us the power to endure our own difficult days. Who both began and finished this race we're in. We're going to study how he did it because he never lost sight of where he was headed, that exhilarating finish in and with God. He could put up with anything along the way, cross, shame, whatever, and now he's there in the place of honor right alongside of God. Every believer needs to have a framework for processing their bad days. Like, how do we respond to the day that's coming, those difficult days, the painful day? We need a framework to apply to those days that's going to allow us to be victorious and not be victims. How many know what I'm talking about? Okay, some of you have been victim to your painful day, your bad days, your whole life. That day has ruled your attitude, your decisions, your family, and it doesn't have to be that way. We need to let's study how Jesus did it and apply that to our life. There were 7 statements that Jesus made on the cross, his last 7 statements. The first one we studied last week, he said, and I think it's important, it's the first thing he said, the first thing Jesus out of his mouth after being crucified was, Father, forgive them. He's on the cross. They resurrect him. Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. And that is so important that it's the first thing, you guys, that when you're going through a bad season or a bad day, the first thing, here's the example of Christ, the first thing that we need to do is forgive those who are making our day bad. Maybe who's offending us, who's hurting us, who's abusing, lying, falsely accusing, all humiliating, all those things that they did to Jesus. When you go through that, if you want to endure and become victorious, if you want to lead by Christ's example, the first thing you got to do is say, God, I forgive them. I forgive them, God. They don't know what they're doing. Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Then Jesus, after that, he says his second statement. And most of you know, when they hung Jesus on the cross, he wasn't alone. He was hung between 2 thieves, right? Jesus' bad day, the worst day of Jesus' life, actually coincided with 2 others' worst day of their life. They were experiencing the exact same struggle. And Jesus, he could have focused on his own problems, on his own pain, couldn't he? Like, it's bad enough. Like, he could have just been like, no, this hurts, it's painful. He could have just focused on his own struggles, but he didn't, because he understood the secret to overcoming that bad day. Luke chapter 23, let's start off at verse 39, and we'll get into Jesus' second statement. It says, one of the criminals who hung there on the cross next to Jesus hurled insults at him. Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us. This is the type of person that when they're having a bad day, they got to make everybody else's day bad. How many of you know them? How many of you work with them? How many have been that person, right? All of us have probably been that person. It's so easy and almost natural to, when you're having a bad day and you're having pain or experiencing something, it's so easy to be cruel to others. It's easy to try to just make everybody else's day so I can feel better about myself. And it's just almost instinctively for us to do that. I remember working for this one guy who we would all ask each other, how's his day? Is he having a good day? Is it a good day? And so we would just say, is it a good day? And we would know when it's a good day and he's happy and he's like, he's on top of it, put in for vacation that day. That's the day you put in. How many of you know what I'm talking about, right? The vacation, and you got to be first. And sometimes people would beat me to it. I'm like, dang it. Everyone's waiting for a good day. Because we know people that are ruled by the day. And here he is. He's having a bad day, so he's just being cruel. And it should be hard to inflict a wound and easy to inspire hope. We have an option here, I think, in the middle of our bad days. You can either be cruel or compassionate. And here is the other person on the cross, heard him. He says, this other criminal rebuked him. Don't you fear God? He said, since you are under the same sentence, we're punished justly, for we're getting what our deeds deserve. But this man, Jesus, has done nothing wrong. Then he said to Jesus, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. So here he is, in acknowledgement of his own sin, an acknowledgement of, yep, I'm suffering because my own deeds, and also an acknowledgement of the lordship of Jesus, that, hey, this is the Son of God. He's the one who's bringing the kingdom of God. Remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus sees his faith and answers him. Here's the second statement on the cross. I tell you the truth. Today you will be with me in paradise. So you have three options on your bad days, on your painful days. It's not in your notes, but you got three options. You can either be cruel, which is easy. It's easy for us to do that. It takes no effort when you're in pain and you're having a bad day just to be cruel to everybody else. You can do that. Or you can, that was one of the thief. The other thief, you can be considerate. You can be considerate of other people's feelings. You can be considerate of other what other people are going through. But that's not the secret now of overcoming your bad day. That's not the secret Jesus shows us in overcoming and enduring your most painful days. That's not enough just to be considerate. Jesus teaches us this third option, which I want to share with you today, is we have the option to be compassionate. Not just be considerate, but to offer compassion. Jesus teaches us one of the most important lessons, how to endure your painful days. Write it down this way. Help others who are experiencing your same struggle. Like that's the last thing sometimes we think about when we're going through it. We're thinking about our pain. If you want to be victorious and endure, you help others who are experiencing the same struggles you're experiencing. We're thinking we're in no shape to help somebody else. We're thinking, I'm the one who needs some help. I'm the one who needs... We believe some lies maybe that have been spoken over us, or the enemy has told us that we're disqualified, that your issues disqualify you, your deficiencies disqualify you. I love what one of our worship leaders told a new worship dream team member that was coming on the team. He told him, you may have a broken past, and there still may be some things that are broken in your life. But I want you to know that God wants to use you in the midst of your brokenness. This is what he told him, and he's telling me. He said, I told him, God wants to use you in the midst of your brokenness. And I'm not going to judge you, but I'm going to come alongside you to see you through to victory in that area of your life. I love that. That man, that I've always dreamed about a church that wasn't, that was for broken people. That's, the church is for broken people. Look, a church without broken people is a broken church. Something's wrong with that church if it doesn't have broken people inside of it. There was this man who was telling me recently, he goes to another church, but he was telling me and another pastor this story, and he was just trying to see how we would react to it. He's trying to gauge like what our philosophy of ministry maybe is or something. He was just telling us about this problem in his church, and he's upset about this problem in his church. He said, you know, there's this man who's coming to my church, who's living with a woman. For years he's living with her, and they ain't even married. And he's saying it like that's a problem. And I'm getting excited, like wow. I told him, I just interrupted and said, hey, that man will always be accepted at my church. I'm telling you. That we will accept him, love him, care for him, equip him, help him in every way. We'll also speak the truth in love with authenticity. That man, look, because the church is for broken people, not for people who are whole and perfect. And some of you think that God is like maybe disqualified you. He has not disqualified you. He hasn't. Some of you think like, well, I don't even have all the answers yet, though. I haven't got it all figured out. You don't have to have it all figured out. God doesn't call perfect people. He doesn't. He just qualifies the imperfect. Okay? And if you're perfect here today, I'm telling you, you're the only one that's not qualified. I'm just telling you. Okay, that's God's church. That's what it looks like. Jesus didn't look like someone who could help someone else, did he? He's on the cross, bleeding, bruised, beaten, marred. He doesn't have anything to offer, but on the contrary, he had so much to offer. Listen, and so do you. Bruised, beaten up by your past, by relationships, by your own decisions, bloodied and beaten up. Listen, you have so much to offer to help people in the midst of your own brokenness, in the midst of your own pain, who other people who are experiencing the same struggles. I'm telling you, if you want to endure this fight, this thing called life, you're going to have to learn how to reach across people who are struggling your same struggle and let God use that for a blessing to somebody else's life. This is one of the secrets to endure that Jesus is showing us here. When you do that, you'll get distracted from your own day. When you're like being used by God in that way, how many have ever like been given somebody, helping somebody, giving them maybe advice about something that you're going through? And then after talking to them, you go, man, I should take some of my own advice. Dang. Come on now. Everybody's done that. But after that, you guys have felt the same feeling of like, you feel almost empowered. It gave you a new perspective on your problem, and now you see the next step out of that darkness because you help somebody else out of that next step. That's what it, and look, helping other people doesn't solve your problems maybe, but it'll give you a new perspective on your problems. And sometimes that's all you need for the next step is a new perspective on your problems. And I want you to be careful in this type of helping other people, though. I need to clarify something because some people think that they're helping other people and they're actually hurting them. So let me kind of clarify something about this, because I'm not talking about helping in the sense of having a pity party with them. Okay, that's not what Jesus did. Now that there's a role for that, like coming along and sympathizing and mourning with those who mourn and crying with those who cry. But that's not the victorious type of help that's going to get them to endure or you to endure your bad day either. Jesus didn't moan with them about their situation, did he? This is so unfair. You're right. No, just not Jesus. Jesus didn't do that. Nor did he. This is not what I'm talking about. The help. Nor did he just give a listening ear to negativity or criticism or gossip. This man is suffering unjustly for what he... That's right. Those religious prideful... No, he didn't do that, did he? Jesus offered real help. The kind of help that actually did something for him. See, when you're able to offer this real compassion, this real help, it does something for you in your life. Look what Isaiah chapter 58 verse 10 says. This is what it does. If you spend yourselves, like if you give your time, your energy, even your words, if you spend yourself on behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed, And check it out. This is what's going to happen for you. Then your light will rise out of your dark day. Your night will become bright like the noonday. Look, here's the recipe. It's in the midst of your night, in the midst of your darkness, if you will just get outside of yourself for a little bit, then God says, I will make the light come out of that dark place. This is the secret. This is one of the secrets to enduring your day that Jesus shows us. I mean, I was so convicted. I went to this homeless outreach several months ago. And on the way to the homeless outreach, you know, I'm going to Starbucks because I need my coffee in the morning. And I go in because the line's too long and I'm in a hurry. I gotta get to my outreach. So I go in there and I order my drink, my venti Americano with steam breve. Okay, everyone who knows me knows my drink. Okay, I go in there, they're like, venti Americano, here he is, you know. So I'm getting but it takes them 10 minutes to get my drink. And I'm late. And I'm not one of those people will tell anyone anything, but inside I'm going, come on, Starbucks, get it together. I got somewhere to be here. I can't go without my Americano. Can't go feed the homeless without my Americano. And so I'm like, so inside I'm just giving this like a little frustration. I'm not really saying anything about it, but I finally get my drink and I get my car, and I'm like, and inside I'm frustrated. I'm already starting off bad. Oh, and I'm just going. And so I get there to the outreach, and we start feeding the homeless. Oh, it's so beautiful, man. How are you doing? I tell one homeless, how are you doing today? I put my hand around. He says, oh, man, I'm so blessed. I got a hot food in my stomach. I got great people to share it with. I'm blessed today. And I felt like this big. Because here I am. I'm telling you, maybe as you step outside of yourself, that's why I always think that you should go on a mission trip. You should go feed the homeless. You need to get outside of your own life just a little bit and just see that you don't have it as bad as you think you have it. And again, it may not solve the problem, but it'll give you a new perspective on your problem. It will, and that helps. That helps you, because right now you're just magnifying your problem and you need to see a bigger picture. And it's easier than you think to do this. It's easier than you think just to help people who are experiencing some of the same struggles. You don't need to have it figured out yet. Well, when I'm done with this season, then I'll be able to tell them how I got out. No, people don't want answers. They want sympathy, okay? And once you know what, you know, people really need, then it's easy to help them. Let me give you the four needs. People need these four things. This is what you can do. This is how you can help. Some of you come in here today, you have one of these four needs, actually. You need some of this. Write these down. Once you know this, it's easy to help people. Because they don't need your answers. They need, number one, support. That's what people need. They need support just to know that someone is standing with them. The most powerful word you can give someone who's going through that bad day is say, you know what? That happened to me too. You know what? Me too. You know what? Yeah, oh, your difficulty in your marriage and your relationship. Yeah, man, we went through that too, man. I mean, I do go through that. Oh, you financial troubles? Yeah, man, Yep, I've been there, man. Those are the most powerful words of help that you can give someone in the middle of their problems is words of just support. And if you have a good support system, you are blessed. You are blessed if you have a good family and good relationships. Most people, just in my own experience, don't have a good support system. And the church is really the one of the only support systems that a lot of people have. This is why discovery groups are so important, so vital, because your bad days are coming. If you're not in one right now, you will get into one, and you need a support system. People that come alongside you and say, me too. Hey, me too. That's what they need. They need support. Number two, people need stability. Stability. They just need something constant in their life. They need something trustworthy. They need something they can rely on in their life. They need someone who's just not going to go, who's going to be there, because everything is changing so rapidly in our world. Principles, values, moral standards, it's all changing. But please listen to this. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. He is the rock, your ever-present help in times of trouble. He is the strong tower that you can run to. He is your stable force. You need stability. Here's the third thing people need, and that is they need significance. Significance. Everybody needs to know that our lives matter. Please receive this today. You are not an accident. Can someone receive that today? You are not an accident. God is involved in your design, in your process, and in your destiny. God is involved. You are not an accident. And significance doesn't come from status. It doesn't come from the emblem on the front of your car. It doesn't come from the logo on your shirt. It doesn't come from your sex. It doesn't come from a bigger salary. Significance, listen, significance comes through service. Significance comes through service. When you start thinking about other people more than you think about yourself and you give your life away, that is the most significant life. Hey, and another thing about significance, you can't be selfish and significant at the same time. You can't. You also cannot be happy and selfish at the same time. That's why we have the launch class around here. It was in the announcements this morning. It's not today. It's actually next week. That launch class is designed to help you discover why you're here on this earth. Like what gifts God has given you. What's the destiny God has for you. What is the significance of your life? That class will help you discover that. And you don't need to be perfect to start doing it. Come next week. You're invited next week to come to that class. Here's the fourth thing that everybody needs. This is the needs of every person. And that is everybody needs salvation. We need Jesus. Here's Jesus on his worst day ever. And he's put in a place. He's put in a position between two thieves, sentenced to death. And they need salvation. They need him. And check this out, please. It's important for you to understand this. Jesus didn't answer the insults. Jesus didn't answer the cruelty being thrown at him. You're not the Son of God. Why, if you are, oh, yes, I am. No, you're not. Yes, I am. Jesus never got into the argument with him. He didn't waste his time on that. And although Jesus had compassion for both of these people, no doubt Jesus loved them both. He was dying on the cross for both of them so that they could have an opportunity to receive him by faith and be with him in paradise. Both of them were going to give both opportunity. He had compassion for them both, but listen, he offered help. He offered compassion to just one of them. Listen, your bad day is going to collide with someone else's bad day. It's going to happen. And you can't save that person. You can't save that person. You're not called. You can't do that. You can have compassion for them and model Christ-like character when people are abusing you, lying about you, rejecting you. You still demonstrate compassion. You don't repay evil for evil. You repay evil for good. And the first thing you do on your bad day when people are doing that to you is you say, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." And some cruel people will see that and they will inspire them to even be more cruel to you. Be forgiving anyway. Some insecure people will see that and will say, "Hey, he's an easy target. She's an easy target. Let me just unload on them." Be compassionate anyway, because there's someone else who's having a bad day, who's in a bad situation, and they're watching you quietly, and they're suffering in silence. And their marriage is on the verge of divorce. And their debt is so high, they feel like taking their life. And their kids are so broken and lost. And they're watching you suffering in silence, enduring the shame, enduring the scorn. And your light will shine. The Bible says, "Let your light shine before men that they would glorify, they would thank your Father in heaven." Look, you can't save the people who are insulting you and who say you're an easy target. You'd be forgiven anyway. You'd be compassionate anyway, because there's someone else who's hurting and watching, and God's going to open up a door for you to help somebody. See, God will use your painful experience. God will use the worst day of your life as a platform to comfort and help somebody else. God uses the cruel people in your life. As difficult as that may seem to understand, he'll use it for good. He'll use even those difficult as an example of supernatural love and peace. It's going to be so attractive to others who have no purpose in their pain. They cannot see beyond the pain that they're currently in. There's nothing to enable them to endure as Jesus endured. It said that he endured with joy. He endured the cross. He was enabled for what was set before him, though. They don't have anything before them. They don't have anything bigger beyond that. people need salvation. Let me give you a few things you can do. Not in your notes, but a few things that you can offer real help to people who are suffering the same things you're going through. You can pray for them. You can do that. How many believe that the prayer of the righteous are powerful and effective? How many know that we're not always righteous, though? How many know that we are the righteousness of Christ? Look, you are the righteousness of Christ. Your prayers, hey, child of God, in the middle of your pain, in the middle of your suffering, in the middle of your experience, in the middle of your issues, your prayers are powerful and effective. I would even say they're more powerful and effective because you can pray from the position of understanding. You understand the pain. You understand the suffering. You can pray for them. Secondly, you can give them a verse. God's word is powerful. Just write them a verse. You can give an encouraging verse. You can speak a verse to them. Third thing you can do is just encourage them. Like, give them some life. Give them some hope. I'm going to give you some of those in just a moment, a few ideas on how to do that. But lastly, you can invite them. Invite them to church. Bring them. Tell them. Come. Invite them to your small group. You can offer real help. You can be compassionate and not just considerate and definitely not just cruel when you're having a bad day. You can be compassionate. And you don't need to have the answers to their problem. You can offer real help. This is what Colossians chapter 3, verse 12 says. It says, therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, put on, clothe yourself with love and compassion. Let me give you three things. In order to be compassionate in the middle of your painful days, you got to do these three things in order for you to endure your painful day and learn how Jesus did it here, helping others who are experiencing the same struggle. Here we go. Here's number one. The first thing we need to do is receive God's forgiveness and love. You can't give what you don't have. It starts with you. Receiving God's love and forgiveness. There was a story of a lady in the Bible who a lot of you know the story of Mary and her alabaster jar. And the Bible says that she came before Jesus while he was sitting with other like religious leaders, and she broke her alabaster jar of oil and she poured it on Jesus' feet, and she was crying so much her tears just wet his feet. This is what it says in Luke 7:47. Jesus says, therefore I tell you that this woman's many sins have been forgiven, for she loved much. But he who has been forgiven little, loves little. You see, those religious leaders that were sitting with Jesus, they had an opportunity. Here was someone in the middle of their bad day. She was known to be a prostitute. And so in the middle of her bad season, they had an opportunity to either offer cruelty and insults and maybe be considerate or even be compassionate. And they offered insults and cruelty. Who is this woman? If Jesus knew who would be touching him, and as she breaks this jar, they say, what are you doing, you crazy woman? That's a whole year's salary. About $40,000 worth of money. And today she broke that jar and poured it on Jesus' feet. And the Bible says she was crying so much it flooded his feet with tears, and she got her hair and she started drying his feet. And Jesus says, because she's been forgiven of much, she loves much. You see, those religious leaders, they didn't have a revelation of their sin. Therefore, they couldn't even be compassionate because they've never received it. See, I don't know where you come from today. I don't know if you have received a revelation of your sin. I don't know if you've been raised maybe in church and maybe you've kind of been going to church your whole life and you're pretty much a good person Or maybe you're just a good moral person and just kind of find yourself in church because that's just what you're supposed to do. But I'm telling you, unless you have a revelation of your sin, you will never be able to have the compassion God desires to have the compassion in your life. And some of you need to pray. You need to ask God, God, give me another revelation, because I've been in my Christian box for so long and surrounded with religious people for so long that I don't recognize my own sinfulness anymore. That when I look on the cross, it's a historical event, it's a nice story, but it doesn't bring me to my knees where I would break everything in my life just to say thank you, God, for what you've given me. I didn't deserve it. But you gave me your love and your grace, and I was so far away from you, God. I didn't deserve it. I deserve death. I deserve death, but God, you loved me anyway, and you took the first step to me before I was ever willing to take a step to you. God, give me a revelation of my wickedness and my sin. Give us a revelation, God, of our distance, of our attitudes, that when we would look upon the cross, we would see, I put you there. It was my attitude. It were my decisions. It was my hurtfulness. It was my sin that drove the nails into your hand, that whipped the whip on your back. That was my, I need a revelation of my sin and my distance and my need of you, God, or else God can't flow his love and compassion through you. This is the first step. And some of you need to ask for that of God. God, let me see it again. Let me see it again. Give me a revelation. Psalm chapter 103 says, praise the Lord, O my soul, and don't forget what he's done for you. Don't forget all the benefits that he's given you. You didn't deserve it. Don't forget it. He's forgiven all your sins, and he heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from that pit that you were in. Do you remember the pit that you were in, the darkness you were in? And he took us out of that pit, and he gave us a crown of love and compassion. This is the first step. If you want to endure your most painful day, you want to be victorious, you're going to have to receive God's love and forgiveness. Here's the second thing in order to do this, to help others in the midst of that, of your own issues and your own problems, to be able to be someone who kind of is compassionate and helps others in the midst of it. Number two, comfort others out of your own experiences. God uses those who have had struggles to comfort others. We don't comfort others from our superior faith. That's not how we comfort others. We don't comfort others with our superior Bible knowledge and our superior faith, but because we have walked in their shoes. That's what comforts. It actually means a lot more to that person. And your pain often reveals God's purpose for your life. God never will waste a hurt. He will never waste a painful season. That the reason why you're actually enduring that is so that God can give you a platform to minister to others. The very thing that you're most ashamed of in your life, the very thing that you resent the most, those issues, those difficulties, they become your greatest ministry in helping other people. 2 Corinthians chapter 1 tells us this. It says, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He's the Father of compassion. Man, he's the Father of compassion. And the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all of our troubles, so that, there's a reason why he gave me that comfort, so that we can comfort others, those in any trouble, with the comfort we ourselves have received from God. This is called redemptive suffering. That's what that's called. That's a theological term for it. Redemptive suffering is when you go through a problem or a pain for the benefit of others. It's actually what Jesus did on the cross. He didn't deserve to be punished, but he went through the shame, the humiliation, the beatings, and the abuse, not just to save you and give you a place in heaven, but so that he can come alongside you in the middle of your brokenness, bad day, worst day ever, and say, me too. Let's go on a journey together. I'll get you out of this. Comfort others with the same comfort you received from God. It's what Jesus did. Receive God's love and forgiveness. Here's number three, the last thing we need to do in order to apply this principle, the second statement Jesus made to help others who are experiencing the same struggles we are. Number three, focus them on the hope of eternity. That's what Jesus did. Let me tell you something. It might not be revelation for you, but can I tell you, heaven is better than Bakersfield? You guys know that? Heaven is better than anything this life can offer, than any blessing, any provision, any status, anything that this heaven is better. And this is something that we can easily lose sight of in the middle of your painful day. That there's that there's a prize at the end of this thing. That heaven is the prize. That it's not going to be perfect here. This world is full of curse and full of sin and wickedness, but there's a prize that's waiting for me. The older generation, like our grandparents, they knew this. Like every hymn that was sung of our grandparents' generation was all about heaven. Like every day they were declaring about heaven, declaring about heaven. It was a prize that they just, nowadays, like when I was, you know, younger, we called them revivals. Right? I mean, have a revival. Right? We have revival meetings, and it was just this just powerful declaration. Life here always falls short, you guys. Here's some verses I use to encourage people. John 14, Jesus says this, and it's actually in the moment where the disciples were so discouraged, and they're coming to him with his discouragement, and here's the help Jesus offers. Don't let your hearts be troubled. I know you're discouraged, but trust in God and trust in me too. In my Father's house are many rooms. I know you got a problem, and you're talking about an earthly problem, but let me give you a heavenly solution. And we always want earthly solutions, right? Give me the solution. Help me have a better now. Jesus didn't always give better nows. He gave you a better future. Not a better now. That wasn't always in the cards to have a better now. He offered you a better future. He says, I would have told you. I'm going there to prepare a place for you. He didn't offer a better now. He offered a better place. Paul called it the blessed hope, Titus 2:13, while we wait for the blessed hope, the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Some of you came in here today and you're needing comfort. Maybe you need that. You need to be comforted. Some of you came in here today and you don't have that hope of heaven. You don't have the blessed hope. And so what you're going through right now, your bad days and bad seasons are so magnified because there's nothing beyond it that you can see. There's nothing beyond it that gives you hope that is bigger than your problem. It's bigger than your situation. Heaven is bigger. And when you have that hope of Christ, you have that hope of eternal life, you have that hope in heaven, everything in this life is put in the proper perspective to the child of God. And maybe you don't have that today. I'd love to give you an opportunity to have that. See, because Jesus was on the cross so that you can have that perspective. He was on the cross and he died so that you can be free. He paid your debt. He paid your penalty of your sin. The distance that you're feeling from God, that's why he died. It was not only to give you a place in heaven, but also to come alongside you in the middle of your painful day, in the middle of your bad earth experience. Maybe you're here today and you need something bigger than your pain. Maybe you need purpose in your pain. Can we bow our heads right all across this worship center? And I want to pray for you right there. Some of you are enduring hardship.